everyone. Thank you for inviting me to come talk at the Arts Bag Lunch. I think I was given Bag Lunch maybe a year ago or 18 months or so, and so it's really great to get to be back. I apologize, I have a cough lozenge because I've got one of these lingering coughs, so hopefully we'll not go flying out, be caught in high definition video to see on your favorite YouTube channel. So yes, I'm working in research IT. I've got a PhD here in 93. My advisor, working with a lot of familiar faces here as well. Our group research IT does. We do research computing services of various kinds for all sorts of people around campus. We have high performance computing clusters. We do consulting around research data management. We actually work with a lot of with the museums to help them manage their collections and develop websites. And recently, I've been working in the visualization technologies for virtual reality, and I like to think that I actually have one of the luckiest, best jobs in the world. It's fascinating. It's just when we're talking to a bunch of biologists about a big concept that we're working on, and now I get to talk about virtual reality with archaeologists. So I feel pretty fortunate. I'll also say, my son, who's a freshman at UC Davis, asked me, "Dad, are you using what you learned in college?" And I actually said, "Every day, because I do IT. Technology is all about culture, politics, history, context. So what I do, what I learned here as a graduate student, working in the quantitative anthropology lab, working on my PhD about ancient technologies, completely applies." And he's like, "Oh, thank you, that was actually helpful." So, visualization technologies. One of the things I want to really talk about is that archaeologists have really been at the forefront of using a variety of visualization technologies for a long time. I want to kind of explore why that is the case. Some examples, photogrammetry, is really just kind of sweeping the field. You know, there's all these articles. Museums are trying to develop programs and really help us kind of document the things that we find and steward in a new way. So photogrammetry, RTI, reflective transformation imaging, as other ways to kind of visualize objects that we're working with and see new things from different perspectives and gather new kinds of information. This isn't just happening within universities. We've got organizations, companies like Cultural Heritage Imaging and SciArc that are really kind of leading the way, and we're so fortunate to have partners like that to work with. And granted, these CHI and SciArc, they're not just concerned with documentation. They're thinking about publication and other things too. But, I think in terms of kind of using these technologies as documentation, we've actually done a lot of work. Of course, there's still a lot to do. One of the really interesting examples, how many people have seen the Gavi Project publication? Okay, so the Gavi Project, this is a project to excavate a house in a Roman house. It's called the Gavi Project. They've been excavating for a couple of decades there. And they decided to try to have an alternative form of publication. Right? So now we're moving kind of from the documentation side into how do you publish this kind of content. So they have a fully online publication called the Mid-Republican House of Gavi. It's a joint project between the archaeologists and the University of Michigan Press. And it's actually still seems to be online free for a while. It was supposed to be up for about 6 months, and then they wouldn't charge for access. But I was able to get in and do all the things without buying the quote-unquote book. So you can go to this publication. You can read the text. You can bring up a three-dimensional model of the house that they've excavated. And you can't really see it here, but there's little trowels there. You can click on those trowels, and it will say something about that level or that feature in the excavation. And there'll be a little window up there, and you can actually then click to get a list of the artifacts found there. And then you can actually virtually walk through this. You click on the little footsteps there and kind of navigate through the house. So, interesting kind of experiment in really making these kind of different kinds of visualizations of archaeological material and contexts and findings available. I found a really interesting article by the authors of the book where they were talking about the point of doing this. Part of the point was they were really trying to make the text also be more readable by a more general audience. So part of this is thinking about how we get this kind of content out to a broader audience. there was very intentional about all of that. Now, we think kind of beyond documentation and into publication and some of these other areas, there's some really great examples from archaeology, from museums, from kind of cultural heritage, really broadly speaking. And I just put up a few examples, things that have been, you know, I just kind of thought about last night as I was putting the slides together with Trina, my PhD advisor. She was probably the goddess of alternative storytelling, because she was always kind of always pushing us to think of new ways to tell our stories and convey information about archaeology and what we're thinking. I remember one time, you know, they still have, I think, the Anthro 290, the lectures every week over in
Monday afternoons,
right? So one time, she made us do, she volunteered us to do a radio show with her. So we all went, she pulled up like three or four graduate students, including me, and we did a radio show about the site of Selamax, one of the sites that she worked on. And there were people in the audience just aghast at this, but that was Ruth, right? She wants to really kind of push that value. Excuse me. And I really appreciate that. We learned a lot from her. We have colleagues at the other UCs who are doing a lot of work here. Nicola Lercari is applying a lot of visualization technologies, drone photography, 3D photogrammetry, crowdsourcing around Bowie State Historic Park. I need to mention Tom Levy and a project that actually helped bring the HearstCAVE visualization wall into the Hearst Museum, and I'll show a slide on that in a second, that was World Heritage and Digital Humanities. Rita Lucarelli, a colleague here from Near Eastern Studies, this is a great site where she's actually taking visualizations, and it's actually part of her scholarship. It's not just pretty things to look at or another way to document things. It's actually, her research is about kind of the three-dimensionality of the written inscriptions that are from like the Book of the Dead that occur on three-dimensional objects, and the spatiality of text on an object. It's kind of fascinating stuff. So this is a website that she and her students and collaborators have developed. I'm not meaning to insult anybody in the room who's already doing it. Well, please get in contact. I'm actually, from my perspective of working in research IT, I'm trying to find out how are people using and developing visualization technologies to kind of push the envelope. So please, there's my email address. Get in touch. I will add you to the next slide. All right. Excuse me. So I mentioned the UC Catalyst project. This is a project actually funded by the University of California system, not the National Science Foundation or NIH or NEH. This is a UC project that colleagues at UC San Diego initiated. They reached out to collaborators at Berkeley San Diego, or Berkeley Merced and UCLA, to develop a network of visualization walls of these platforms at the four different campuses, with the goal of having a way to preserve and share information about cultural heritage sites that are at risk from it's erosion or terrorism. This would be another way to preserve and share information about this kind of information, for this kind of content. The project also includes some crowd watching, or crowdsourcing to identify and kind of monitor sites that might be at risk. And it's a partnership with a library that's doing some preservation of the content, and between some technology providers also. So it's really an exciting project. It kind of helped, between Rita's work on 3D coffins and this project, you see the Catalyst project, that was kind of the beginning of at least my involvement in what we're starting to do now. But as we do this, a lot of questions do come up, right? So what are the standards? And this is something we wrestle with all the time. We'll get more into this later, but the file formats and things like that are crazy. There are no standards. It's a wild, wild west. So that makes it hard to preserve. Well, what do you keep? The files are really large. So what do you keep? How do you make sure that this stuff is available in the future? It does raise issues about publication. So the Michigan example, there are a very small handful of examples where people are really trying to develop new publications as their primary outputs that use those kinds of these kinds of visualizations. Then also, can you actually recreate these visualizations? Could somebody else take my photographs and use the same software and get the same three-dimensional model? Is the content that I'm creating reusable by others? And finally, just kind of the technology access and equity issue. These are expensive. The hardware is expensive, the software is expensive, the staff time is expensive, so who has access to these technologies and who doesn't? I think there are a lot of other fundamental questions here. So why are archaeology and museums, why are they such good places for this work to happen? Because I think there really is something there. I want to really emphasize that and find people to work with me on this. But you know, what do we mean by visualization? Does data visualization fit into this? Is photography visualization? Is GIS visualization? I mean, in a lot of ways it is, right? As we think about virtual reality, you know, there are characteristics of immersive visualization that are giving us new opportunities and new ways to engage with students, with our publics, and our other stakeholders. Talk about those now, right? Fascinating as they are, maybe we can have some discussion too about some of those questions. But I do want to ask, you know, what else can we do with these technologies? And rather than what can they do for us, how do we use them? They're just tools, right? And if I learned anything about technology, it's not the technology allowing us to do things, it's about the context and our use that is important to think about. So now, to talk a little bit more about the Hearst Cave itself. So first of all, what is it? Well, physically, it's a visualization wall that's over in the Hearst Museum. How many people have actually seen the Hearst Cave over in the Hearst Museum? Great, thank you. So, you know, as you can see, this is really six TVs turned on their sides like this, attached to a very powerful computer. So it's really just when you could go to Best Buy and your local computer store, basically, and buy this thing and then set it up. In fact, that was one of the points of the UC Cavers project was instead of having some expensive, you know, libraries go to these really expensive vendors to set up some proprietary visualization wall, but you know, for an order of magnitude less, you could build it yourself. So that's been part of the project. So it's a place and it's a set of TVs, but it's also, I think of it really as a series of projects that are really building in a number of really interesting directions. What a lot of the projects really started with just the premise of let's really see if we can do something to document museum collections, cultural heritage, artifacts, and objects. So you can see a couple of the, I'm not showing you the 3D model and spinning it just in the interest of time here. But this has been, you know, one of the reasons we got the Hearst Museum involved and how they got engaged and excited is they wanted to explore what would it mean to document their collection using three-dimensional models. Now, it's also, I really wanted to work with students to do this, partly because I didn't have anybody on my team that I worked with who had time to do this, and I don't really have time either, but I'm kind of making it. But I thought, wow, this would be great, let's hire some students, let's have a student team. And that has really kind of evolved to be one of the kind of major themes about the work we're doing, and part of it that's so exciting to me and to my colleagues around campus. So you can see here a few pictures here on the left where we were with Ben Porter in the actual big collections facility in Richmond, doing some photography. And Ben will, this is in the basement of the Hearst Museum, doing some photography there. Kate Fleming on the left, and then we're actually using the Hearst Cave computer and workstation to do the photogrammetry. Because it turns out, because it's a nice big computer and lots of screens, it turns out to be a great place to actually do the photogrammetry processes too. And the student involvement and kind of, we've had a lot of fun, we've made a lot of mistakes, a lot of errors, but come up with a lot of good results as well. So the student part has been really exciting. So for me, it's also an experiment. I think I mentioned, I'm really trying to find out what kind of visualization technologies do people need on campus, to faculty and students and postdocs and others need in order to really, you know, make this, or in order to keep exploring how these technologies can help us out. So you can see here a couple of pictures where it's been such a social exercise of trying to figure out how to make things work. There's Nico over here and Michael Ashley. I think they're talking to a donor who Ben had brought in, just walked in, that Ben had brought into the museum. This is stuff people want to, again, when we're in the museum doing this work, people come in and they watch us. So it's kind of turned out that we're an exhibit in the museum as well. And it's been exciting to have students working with objects, working with museum staff, and visitors coming by to watch. They want to see this. It's been actually kind of remarkable. And I really want to, you know, take advantage of that, that energy to the next level. So a number of questions have always come up as we think about the next step in the work that we're doing. Now, what are the best kind of technologies, the best practices that we can develop? What can we do to really make sure that the three-dimensional models are used, that they're engaging content, that they're developed into applications that people can take advantage of? How can we make this content faster? How can we develop the content in a more reasonable time frame? It takes a lot of time and energy to create some of these models. And then again, how do we preserve the content? What content do we actually keep? And I'm also kind of pitching this out. These technologies are actually in demand in the workplace. For students who aren't going into cultural heritage and into archaeology, but maybe going into gaming development, computer game development, or whatever else, or even marketing, the development of three-dimensional visualizations and technologies and the software that we're using are in high demand. So that's something that has resonated. One of the funded projects was actually from the Student Technology Fund. They have a pool of money that you can apply to. That in addition to paying for software licenses like Microsoft and Adobe, they'll fund kind of small and even some large projects. So that was one of the funding sources for this effort. I definitely talked about it, kind of skill development. So these kind of questions. And again, I'm not going to go into those in great detail, but actually I can't resist a few slides that I just recycled from some other presentations where you can see here this is a former anthropology undergrad doing some photography in the Hearst Learning Center. The content, I'm trying to emphasize content, the content that we're developing and that we have access to here as archaeologists, as cultural heritage professionals, is really compelling. So I go over and I talk to people in computer science where they're developing the next generation where we're really figuring out what are the algorithms that you use to study get all the information from the photograph. How can you so they're really on the kind of computer science side, they're always looking for partners who have content, and right, that's us. And then again, the student engagement part has been kind of so exciting, and taking that to the next level is one of the things we're planning on. But again, you can't just take the models; you also have to build them into applications. Take that content, put it in applications, and really think about the storytelling perspective too. So when you get into the kind of application development, then you really what is the story that you're trying to tell? So we've had a number of brainstorming sessions. I'll talk about that in a little bit. Now, we actually started this about 2 years ago doing our initial photogrammetry. I think that's about right, maybe 2 years ago. And the project has grown. We've gotten a number of small pockets of funding and gradually kind of expanded the scope of what we're doing. And so, for instance, we recently did a large number of nets we came from the Hearst collection. We really want to dig into that and find out how we can tell stories around that particular collection. And then we also, one of the kind of expanded projects was we're part of a grant that the Mellon Foundation has given to North Carolina State University. And they then gave sub awards, kind of sub grants, to five universities. So it's us and Brown University and Indiana and a couple others to develop kind of a national cohort of universities that are developing visualizations for, particularly for libraries and learning spaces. research or in a library context. And they looked at us and said, wow, you're working with museums. That's great. That's a learning space. So they brought us on board. And that's allowed us to reach out to some of the other collections on campus. So for instance, we've done a collection of pine cones at the University of Jefferson area. We've started working with some of the outdoor sculpture from the Berkeley Art Museum Pacific Film Archive, and we're in conversation with the library and the Temple Garden, excuse me, about developing some 3D models for that. And my secret goal here is to take this collection of collecting institutions and use this 3D visualization approach to rethink about kind of collections at Berkeley. There's so many amazing collections here on this campus, and I want to find a way to bring that community together to have another way to tell the story of what UC Berkeley is doing through all these fantastic collections. This was a grant for about $40,000, but the vice thing when I was trying to find the PIs for the grant, Kathy Koshland, who's our Vice Chancellor for Undergraduate Education, and Larry Conrad, who's our Chief Information Officer, said, yeah, no, I want to be the PI. No, not. No. So we made sure that both those people were PIs. So that just kind of speaks to how this is also really attractive to campus leadership. More on that side. All right, another kind of an expansion, another direction this went, is that we've been talking with, Ben Porter, through the UC Catalyst project, was interested in funding another one of these visualization walls someplace else on campus. We started talking to the Moffitt Library about installing one there because they were developing a makerspace and doing some interesting interactive uses of space, and they were doing some VR development and things like that in the Moffitt basement. But for various reasons, we couldn't do that. And it turns out that was very good because a few weeks ago they had a massive flood and it destroyed a bunch of computer equipment. And so, hooray for us that they couldn't actually get their act together. So instead, we've installed another visualization wall, very much like what we have in the Hearst, over in Sitardi Dai Hall in the Citrus Tech Museum. So this to me is really cool. So now we've got a visualization wall in the Hearst Museum of Anthropology, Archaeology, Cultural Heritage. And we have another visualization wall up in engineering and computer science building. And so I really want to kind of build some, what's the connection there? The connection to me is museums, it's a very different kind of museum. They're showing off their makerspace stuff. And museums and student engagement. So that's something that we're going to be exploring, is how we can then really use that space and use then the connection of two different visualization walls and student themes, creating different kinds of content and bringing them together and mash them up and see what sorts of exciting things happen. So that's the Citrus Tech. All right, then the next direction we go. Citrus, which is the organization in Sutardia Dai Hall, has an annual funding call for seed funding for small projects, and we applied to get some funding to develop, to take this into the direction of virtual reality. So I'm going to talk with Rita Lucarelli. This looks like a really good way for us to do some work in virtual reality, to kind of extend the work on 3D modeling and the application development we've been doing into VR, but we need to have a partner at another UC that's part of the Citrus program. Do you have any ideas? And she said, well, my colleague Elaine Sullivan, just down the street here, is an archaeologist, and she actually works she's an Egyptologist, but she works at the kind of the landscape and the GIS level. Okay, so let's talk about that. So we ended up applying for a grant called Visualizing Ancient Egyptian Landscapes and Material Culture, Cultural Context for Immersive Visualization in VR, and that we did get the award to do that work. So the way we kind of describe this is that we're going to integrate the work of two digital humanists who are developing these cutting-edge applications using visualization technologies in archaeology, photography, history of art, and history. Excuse me. And they're both partners who are also really trying to push the envelope on kind of alternative forms of publication. So there's really some really good synergies coming up here. And in addition, it turns out that even though Rita works on sarcophagi and hieroglyphic inscriptions at the very kind of micro object level, and Elaine works at the landscape level, creates GIS models and kind of sight lines as they change over time. She calls them 4D GIS. Turns out they're actually working on material from some of the same sites, like some of the same areas, like Saqqara in Egypt. Wow, there's some great serendipity here. How can we bring these together? And then this is actually where I went back and put my Ruth Trillian hat on, and she would always talk about multi-scalar approaches. That's what this is. We've got two different scales of analysis. How do we pull these together into what kind of VR application with the goal of telling a story about ancient Egypt? So we developed a storyboard, right, that would start at the regional level, allow you to go to the landscape, into the tomb, see the sarcophagus, and then look at the hieroglyphics. That's kind of the basic kind of flow that we're trying to build. Did anybody from my student team actually end up showing up? It doesn't look like it. They probably used the rain and midterms or something like that, which is too bad. Actually, Jess Johnson, who's a graduate student in Rita's group in leadership studies, has really been central to this. But we have 500 graduate students working with us as well, and working on different aspects of this project. So we had this idea of how to how the user would experience this different kind of content. Where we are right now, we actually started up in earnest in October. We were supposed to start up in August or September, but we really started in October. And so on the left, you can see a screenshot from the Unity development environment. So we're using some software called Unity that's used to make a lot of the computer games and things like that these days. You can just see the doctor's, the sarcophagus that's inside a tomb here. So I just asked one of the students to just give me a screenshot so you can see it's very specialized software with lots of things that you have to do. You have to be able to code in C# and stuff that's well beyond me. And then over here you can see we actually have our first prototype of a VR application, which really just took you into this environment, and you could come over, you could look at the sarcophagus, and you could reach down and touch it, and just touching the surface would kind of light it up. Mm-hmm. Wanted to demonstrate a way to interact with this. The goal is that once we have this really fully developed, you could look at the hieroglyphics and you could touch one, and it would float up a panel or something that would give you actually the translation of that part of the text. So that's kind of where we're going. And on the right, you're seeing Jess Johnson from Immersive Studies give a demonstration to one of a German colleague from LMU in Munich, who was out, late November. We had a workshop in the Hearst Museum and the Learning Center with our colleagues from LMU in Munich. And they were some of the first guinea pigs to actually try on the headset and look at our very first, pre-alpha release of this virtual reality experience. Some of the things that I observed there were that actually very few people have used the headsets. And because we've been doing this project, just kind of forgotten that fact. So that just the very active, even though the there weren't any hieroglyphics, and you would touch this thing and it would kind of light up yellow, and the students have been working late, they've made some very interesting decisions. So they knew that the size of the tomb, the physical tomb that the doctor was in, was actually, it's not this tall, right? So it's kind of wide. But they're like, well, it's too short. So we're gonna push the ceiling up. And then somebody said, this thing needs a window. Let's put a window in it. And I pointed out later, it's 30 meters underground, so a window is probably not necessary. But so when these colleagues who are Egyptologists from Munich put the headset on, they compl- size of this room. And there's a window there, and you can see some grassy hills. But just the fact that of being in the immersive, you know, kind of VR environment and being able to see an object that was meaningful to them, they were totally impressed, right? So it was very successful from that perspective. And I gotta say, I have not used the headset we're using is called HTC Vive. I've only used it a few times, but I've been really impressed. So it's nothing to ask. How many people have actually used a Vive or Oculus or one of these other devices? Okay, good. Yeah, so about half. And any observations about, does that sound right? Is it hokey or is it actually kind of cool? I think so too. I think, you know, there's been a lot of people saying, like, oh, this is just the hype around this technology. And people were saying that VR was going to take off 10 years ago. But, you know, it seems to me that we're actually at that inflection point where stuff is starting to happen. And actually, I think there's actually huge opportunities for archaeologists because, frankly, I thought, oh, I'll be able to look at, you know, there'll be dozens of great archaeology and kind of history examples in VR. Wow, there's maybe one or two, and at least half of them are crappy. So there's actually, I think, would be an opportunity here. So some themes and tensions as we went through this work. So, and I wish Rita were here because she could describe how she and Elaine have actually had to kind of re-excavate through the field notes and old photographs and talking to colleagues what the find context that we're trying to reconstruct looked like. It's been fascinating, and someday we'll tell some stories about how we've gotten some photographs, but we're not supposed to tell the excavator who's currently at the site. And, it's like archaeological espionage or something going on. Fascinating stuff. But to really figure out we want to reconstruct this environment, so we need to know what that looked like, and you know, sort of excavated in 1903 or something like that. And then there's been this really interesting tension about maybe trying to create an exact replica, more or less, understanding this is a reconstruction, or be trying to create like an immersive experience. So what do you do about the fact that the tomb is up here and you know, in VR, it's not physically there, so your head does this kind of weird clipping thing that you can just imagine. So you need to take that into account. So how do you design the experience to be immersive and interesting and telling the story you want to tell, but also as realistic as you want it to be? And I think that's where you have to know, what are your objectives for this application? So what are your learning objectives for what you're trying to accomplish here? Some other things. And this was kind of surprising to me. I thought, well, yeah, you know, other people are doing this, and I'm hearing about VR this, VR that. So, you know, the development's going to be hard, but it won't be, you know, we'll just hit kind of our usual obstacles, and we'll just be able to plow through those. Well, it turns out that what we're doing is actually quite different. Right? So we're trying to take landscape models that were developed in our GIS and combine them with three-dimensional models that were generated by photoscan photogrammetry, and combine them with other kind of a reconstruction of the tomb that was built in Maya or Blender, and bring those into Unity. And Unity's really good at like taking in files from different kinds of software. Well, it turns out this has been really hard, and we're actually having to get some computer science students on board who've done some of this and can really look more deeply into the guts of some of the files and some of the applications to make this work. And as I talk to people, so part of this Mellon grant, I'm around and talk to these people, they've experienced some of this, but we're right on the edge of doing something quite different. And so then, so those are the applications, but it's part of that's driven by people like Elaine, who's from GIS, who thinks about landscapes, and Rita, who thinks about epigraphy and three-dimensional, she's pushing the edge with kind of three-dimensional models. So there's, even though they're both Egyptologists, both archaeologists, they come at these with these different perspectives, and how we bring that together into a shared visualization is actually kind of an interesting design process. Again, surprisingly few really good examples to follow. there's some interesting stuff with ancient Rome. Actually, does anybody have anything they would like to mention to me that I should go look at? A good VR example, or whether it's a game or a cultural heritage experience? Yeah, just a
colleague of mine named Castico Call, who got his degree here in architecture, is teaching gaming in the UK.
Yeah.
And this January, he brought his game with his students to the NBA meetings, and there you wear the headset and you walk around the site of Tiwanaku. Archaeologists, you're outside.
Yeah. What's his name?
Bocal, B-O-C-A-L. I can send you his email address.
Great.
Costco Bocal. So they're trying to make a game.
Excellent.
But in that, in so doing, they're reconstructing the site, and you in the game will be able to walk around the site.
Fantastic. Any other examples, things I should look at? If you think of them, send me a note. Because again, it's kind of interesting how new this is. Excuse me. So the technology problems are really hard. And it turns out that, you know, the technologies, the software we're using, the kind of even just kind of dealing with digital photos, right? These are some very specialized technologies. So a lot of us have years of working with experience working with Photoshop, but what about Maya and Blender and some of these other tools? These take a long time to learn, actually, to become really good at. And the technology is moving very fast. The VR and augmented reality spaces, the headsets that are being developed, the software changes, this stuff is changing really quickly. And it's hard to find good expertise, right? So there's actually, over in engineering, there's an Hive Center, where there's a faculty member that's really interested in kind of computer vision and kind of developing the hardware side. And so there's a few things here and there. There's actually someone in architecture, CED here, Luisa Collins. I don't know if anybody's met her. So she's an architect, and also she has a position at LBL, and she's really interested in, you know, she's creating VR environments of buildings, right? And using that as a way to visualize what's happening. And you've probably seen the examples from real estate is now doing virtual walkthroughs and things like that. So she's actually taking that to the next level from an architecture perspective. So creating good content, it's there, but it's hard and it's expensive. So we're really, you know, I kind of determined, ergo, we are at the leading and bleeding edge of this. And thanks to my student team and my collaborators, because they've been great partners on this, and it really has been like a process of discovery and hitting brick walls and breaking through them and making decisions to try something different. Been fascinating. So for the team out there, thank you. So really, is it worth it? And we've had some very frustrating moments, but I won't read this quote, but I'll leave it up there for you to read from a series of articles on virtual reality and augmented reality that were written by these two people, Henry Craig and Maya Jardeva, for EduCause Review. EduCause is an organization that's kind of higher ed information technology professional, and they had a series of articles back in 2017 that talked about what's starting to happen. And just to kind of give you a sense of how fast change is happening, when I read this, aside from this art, this, you know, this makes sense, like, I resonate with this, but some of the things that they were pointing to as examples, and they were talking about some of the hardware vendors and software vendors, half of whom have gone out of business since then and been replaced by. So this 2017 article seemed quaint, you know, when I read this. It's that kind of experience, yeah. So I do think it's absolutely worth it. In fact, I've submitted a grant for another student tech fund, another proposal to the student technology fund to really take this now from virtual reality into augmented reality. So this is where you'd use a device like this is the Magic Leap that's on the right. With virtual reality, you're basically closed off, right? You're blind and you're being shown a set of displays that make it look three-dimensional. But you're going to walk right into anything nearby. In fact, you need to have a spotter nearby to actually help you or keep you from walking into the desk or the wall. With augmented reality, you actually have a pair of glasses that you can see through, and those are then also showing you images. So you could see, you could go into the Hearst Museum where the sarcophagus of the doctor is sitting, and you could look at it and use a gesture like this or something, and the hieroglyphics would then float up and say something to you. You're actually seeing it there in the museum. That's where we want to go next with augmented reality. How many people, how many people have read the campus strategic plan that was published in November by Carol Priest on campus? Okay, so thank you. Yeah, so this is, for me, this is really interesting because we actually have a strategic plan that was published by the campus, leadership. That's kind of mind-blowing. Excuse me. Some of the things that are in that campus plan really spoke to me that said what we're doing right now with the Hearst Museum, with the Hearst CAVE, are just connect so well to the strategic plan. There's a big emphasis on creating student discovery experiences. It's like, okay, we're doing that in so many places already. Yeah. But this is another area we kind of really want to be able to articulate how this kind of work in virtual reality and visualization for cultural heritage connects to the campus strategic plan. A lot of then kind of research and agendas, signature initiatives that have a lot to do with data, individualization, and health, and data democracy, and things like that. And so these are also things I'm really interested in connecting this work to. I work with all of you, frankly. In the interest of time, I really think that visualization, virtual reality, augmented reality, visualization walls have a lot of opportunities to help us with scholarship, research, teaching and learning, engagement with students, with stakeholders, with philanthropy, with donors. So it's very fruitful and interesting to have. So let me stop there because I think we might have 3 or 4 minutes for questions and discussion. I'm really interested hearing the things that you'd like to see, the things that you're hearing people are doing with these kinds of technologies. So thank you. Questions or examples, or things that you would like to see, any ideas? Ben?
Yeah, I'm really excited about something that's happened in Vienna with the Historisch Museum recently. I meant to send you the link. I think it happened right before the winter break, where they showed very high resolution. I don't necessarily think that the paintings are in three-dimensional space, but they're very high resolution pictures of paintings. And then they're presenting them. They're just going to walk out.
Good to see you here, too. We're buying a drink.
Okay.
Double drink.
That's what I figured. But what they've done is they take all the renderings and they present them in a sort of three-dimensional gallery that they've developed. And so you can then move through the space and then zoom in at incredibly high resolution on these complicated portraits, 16th century portraits, or zoom back out. And so you can then engage with the image in a way that you couldn't necessarily engage with it in the gallery because there are guards or there are cases that keep you from zooming in that much. But I like that example because it gets us over the $220 million hurdle of building a new Hearst Museum for all of our objects, where we can actually be presenting. I think in the future, in 10 years, we'll be curating exhibits in virtual space as much as we're using our physical space. So we just need to get the content developed through these kinds of initiatives of curating. Thank you.
Excellent. Yeah, I've always wondered about, you see a painting in a gallery, it is very three-dimensional.
Yeah.
And those are so textured, right? And that just strikes you in a different way than when you're looking at a computer screen or a book. Right? So God, I'd love to capture the texture of things. Other questions, suggestions, directions? Yes?
I was interested in your collaboration with the Botanical Guardian. And specifically, I have a thought about using machine learning for automated climate identification.
Ah,
so, cool.
with things like plants and things like. So then, if you think about some of the other few trends in when it comes to intelligence and machine learning to really help with the machine generated identifications and things like that, which yeah, that could certainly be applied in an archaeological context as well. Right?
You can't always export things anymore to a herbarium, you know, if you could take a really good picture in the location.
Yeah.
You could take your type collection with you.
That's right. That's right.
Which is what I think you were referring to.
I tried it a little bit with the NASA project, and it worked well. And then I actually wanted to increase it, so let's make a brand identification. So you basically make like an interface to have a pool of people participating and submitting data. And then this is how you feed in your system.
Right.
But then you make top-bottom curation to label what is actually the morphology or whatever characteristics you want to emphasize. And then you actually make a measure of certainty, because not everything, like I said, it is saying this is all the plant. But there is doubt, it looks like other plant. So you get a measure of certainty that this is all it, like 90%, 80%. I have colleagues that already enforced it to do archaeology and bioarchaeology. So I hope we get an accurate thing.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Interesting. Right. Remind me your name.
Amr.
Yeah, Amr, yeah. Right. You're from UCLA, right?
Yeah. Sorry?
Are you from UCLA?
UCLA.
All right. Thank you.
Excellent. I've been doing this as my mentor here.
UCLA. Yeah,
that's
right.
Sure. I just wanted to ask about, you showed the Gabi project, and there's a few examples out there of sort of these people exploring new forms of integrating digital and location. And given that our discipline, research depends on things like citation, are you, with your project with Rita, thinking of it and being used for research purposes, say you pull out something, you do some work with this thing that you've read, how do you, is there anything about how someone might cite that, or how is that going to become sort of continually accessible for research purposes.
Yeah. It's so important, and I'll admit this is like the dirty laundry of the project. We're creating these models, we're building them into applications, but in terms of we're just getting into the point where we can ingest these like into collection space, which is a collection management system used by the Hearst Museum, which is another system that my team manages. But even there, we're even with collection space, we're just starting to get to the point where we're going to try to create digital object identifiers, DOIs, or some kind of persistent identifier for these objects, aside from their accession number, because it turns out accession numbers are supposed to be unique, but they're not. So we're really trying to, that's kind of the next direction. So the idea is that these would all be citable objects. So what about, should the, just the mesh be a citable object? Because that actually turns out to be a very valid subject of study, because it's a three-dimensional form without the colors on it. It turns out to be pretty informative sometimes, right? So should that be citable? If you did research on the mesh, would you cite the mesh? No perfect answers, but that's certainly one of the things we're thinking about. Yeah, thank you.
I was wondering if you're using business scaling at all to integrate different scales.
I have not. I want to. So I see the trainings go by, I'm like, I've got to get up to the R for another thing.
We were talking to SciArt people, and they're using laser scanning and photogrammetry at a scale much bigger, which is often more of a site scale.
Yeah.
But they'll use the laser scanning as its high precision as kind of it's like a backbone on which they stick all these photogrammetry details, and high precision, and like half a kilometer away. And they're mostly working in Autodesk Recap, which apparently is really good at integrating different data sources.
Yeah, right.
And it's free for student documents.
Yeah. That's true, no, but I have to say, ARF and Nico in particular are one of our local experts here on campus, one of those pockets of excellence and expertise that we turn to. There's so many different avenues here that I would love to spend time on.
important because this all seems expensive,
mm-hmm.
and you mentioned that, but I mean really expensive. So if it, if they have got something that's accessible, I mean that's kind of a European version or something on
yeah.
campus, then students actually could do their own. Is this kind of what you're suggesting, that they could actually have their own projects without these huge grants? I mean, it sounds kind of
yeah.
daunting.
Yeah, I think, you know, if there was kind of a campus, kind of some infrastructure for this, like places where you could check out laser scanners, good digital cameras, computer labs that had the software, tutorials and guidelines, and then a way, you know, kind of like your app is a way that, you know, people know that's a place where I want to do some research as an undergraduate, so, and faculty and grad students said, I need to get some students to help me with this project, so we have some way to create, you know, the structure for that, then it has a better chance of self-assembling.
Yeah, happening.
Yeah.
Multiple locations.
I think that's really the campus strategic plan. That's the challenge, is how do you actually scale up things, some of the things that are very successful.
Well, could all those softwares go to do that?
Or
are they just so expensive they can't possibly do it?
Yeah, I think so the software licensing is definitely part of the challenge here. I mean, we're wrestling with the software that we're trying to license on a daily basis, right? So to expand into something to, so if the software, I think it's almost more the kind of expertise. So learning how to use the software and helping people get through them the next episodes of consulting.
Yeah.
Okay, now you've learned how to use the software. But to really get it to do what you want to do, you need to get several hours in and then even tens of hours in and then have a real expert help you. Evan, do you have thoughts on
that? That's a challenging question. With the kind of open science revolution, right, that's only half the battle. While we see data and workflows and things published in open formats, there's still the problem of how do we transmit the methods to the people who want to use them, either for from a career trajectory perspective or for some one-off research project. So if we're coming from archaeology or anthropology, chances are we don't have that stats training or programming or computer science training. So how do you select the most appropriate method from this overwhelming sea of techniques, right? So you still, like you said, you still have to kind of immerse yourself, but then who and where and when and why do you reach out for that help? So
yeah.
And those are the holes we try to plug. So
yeah. D-Lab's a very good resource for those of you who haven't been able to go. They have excellent trainings and workshops and community building.
Yeah, so it seems like about half your workflows, it could be open, like lenders, open source. There is some photogrammetry software, but a lot of that's proprietary. It's the gaming software.
Well, everyone, thank you so much. I really enjoyed the invitation to come and talk. It's always great.